Hey, what's going on, YouTube? I'm back with some more Thomas Sowell. Yo, listen, if you are new coming to my channel, hey, I want to say thank you for coming through. My name is Wally, and you are now tuning to Playboy Hustlers TV.
Hey, this is King of Melodies Beat.
Listen, this one right here is called Black Rednecks and White Liberals, you hear me? So let's see what he's talking about over here, all right? Yeah, you know Thomas Sowell never let us down. He always speak that truth, you understand me? He's not about that race card, and he's definitely not a race hustler, you heard? So let's get right into this, man. I'm gonna stop wasting your time. Go ahead and press play. Before I do that, though, make sure you go and check the links in my description, all right? Also, hit up the playlist. I got a playlist for him on there, all right? So make sure you go there, all right? Yeah, man. Yeah, but make sure you check the playlist out as well, all right? So with that being said, I'm going to go ahead and press play.
Black Rednecks and White Liberals by Thomas Sowell. Mm. Over 30 books published. How important is this book to you?
Probably it may be the most important, because there are so many misconceptions about racial and ethnic issues that just straightening out the misconceptions is a major task in itself. Hmm. I don't reach any kind of policy conclusions in this book, because, as I say, it's just a full-time job to get the facts straightened out.
Yeah, that's a full-time job, baby. And you know your man right here, he's like doing overtime, because he come with facts on top of facts on top of facts. Dispute that. Let me see.
I can write a column in a newspaper aimed at the general public, and there'll be extremely few misunderstandings of what I said. I can say the same things in a book that's aimed at intellectuals, and there'll be incredible twists and turnings. Well, he seemed to say this further than that. I remember one huge review trying to figure out the implications of ethnic America. What made it a farce was that the last chapter of the book is titled Implications. So you don't have to guess what the implications I drew. They're right there. But I strongly suspect the person who wrote the review never got that far.
Hmm.
Black rednecks, who are they?
These would be blacks who came out of the Southern culture and who carried that culture with them north into the urban ghettos and into the ghettos of the South, for that matter, and who have not moved out of that culture since. Over the years, both blacks and whites have moved away from that culture.
Sound like you're talking about people that be deep in the country, like deep in the country, where it's like one store that everyone there goes to, everyone knows each other's name. I think that's what you're talking about.
But in the poorest and worst of the ghetto areas, there are lots of people who have not. And these kinds, it's a culture which didn't do whites any good, and it's certainly not doing blacks any good today. And the tragedy is that people regard this culture as somehow the authentic black culture, and therefore you're not to interfere with it. It's to be allowed to, and so they're cheering people on. It reminds me of a scene in The Blue Max where this general is encouraging this daredevil pilot to do all kinds of wild stunts, you see, knowing that the guy's gonna kill himself if he keeps doing this, and therefore the general will be rid of a political problem.
And that's what's going on today, you hear me?
Now, I don't think that the white liberals are doing this deliberately, but I think the net results are the same. They are cheering blacks on and doing things that are absolutely self-destructive.
What's the difference between a black redneck and a white redneck?
Color.
No difference. They all share the same thing.
Same kind of people, same attitudes.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. And same kind of results. One of the things I point out in this book is that, you know, as late as the First World War, when mental tests were given in the Army, there were whites from any number of Southern states who scored lower on those tests than blacks from Northern states. So that anyone who comes out of that culture is likely to score lower on mental tests, to do less well in intellectual areas, whether they're black or white. Among the middleman minorities, of which the Jews are the most prominent, the hostility to these people in countries around the world is out of all proportion to that, to any other kind of group I can think of. In terms of the violence, the number of Chinese killed, let's say, in 1 year.
Sometimes just listening to this, you get a little upset, you know what I mean? Like, how come I ain't know all this before?
And by mob action, exceeds all the blacks lynched in the entire history of the United States. And the number of Armenians killed in Turkey, you know, during the First World War is greater than that. And of course, the number of Jews slaughtered on a number of occasions in history, even before the Holocaust, is greater than that. So that the question is why this particular kind of people are the targets of so much venomous hatred. And I think the answer is that they not only succeed, they succeed in a way which is a threat to the egos of other people. That is, you can envy a Rockefeller, but he's no threat to your ego because you say, listen, anybody can be rich if he's born a Rockefeller.
That's fact. Yeah, you can't blame the new Rockefellers. They have nothing to do with what's going on right now. But at the end of the day, this is why you got to start your own dynasty. So your lineage, hey, they'll be set. You understand what I mean?
But the guy who comes here, let's say from Vietnam or Korea, and arrives here with little more than the clothes on his back and a few words of broken English, and a decade later he has his own little business, and you see his son a few years after that getting ready to go off to Harvard or MIT, you got to ask yourself, you either got to, you know, you've got to hate yourself for saying, my God, I've been stagnating, this guy was nothing, and now he's risen up, or you're going to have to hate him. And most people, when they have a choice between hating others and hating themselves, they hate others.
Word.
Where does the hatred for the Jews come from in history?
That was deep right there. You hear what he said?
Thing, and now he's risen up. Or you're going to have to hate him. And most people, when they have a choice between hating others and hating themselves, they hate others.
Where does the hatred for the Jews come from in history?
Number of places, but they are people who have succeeded an awful lot in the midst of other people who have not. Years ago, one official of one of the Jewish organizations in New York asked me, what can Jews themselves do in order to minimize the hostility they face? And I gave him a one-word answer, fail.
I want to see why he said this.
Because as long as you succeed, you're going to be hated.
You hear that? As long as you stay on top and you never take a step down just for a second to breathe some of that air, they're going to always go after your head. That's what he's saying right here. And it's true. I know we can all attest to that, right?
Slavery was much bigger and involved infinitely more people than people have realized. It was not confined by race. It was not defined by race or created by race. It existed for thousands of years. A history professor had a student come up to him and ask him, when did slavery begin? And he said, you're asking the wrong question.
You know, when I was younger, they taught us that slavery started right here when they took people off the Pinta, whatever the other boats were called. Yeah, that's what they told us. And Christopher Columbus was this nice guy. And man, listen.
The question is, when did freedom begin? Because slavery existed as long as we have any records. And from archaeological finds, we realized that people were enslaving other people before they could read and write. So that's always existed, and it's existed all over the world. The number of white people enslaved by pirates in North Africa was greater than the number of Africans brought to the United States. You know, and yet that's not even mentioned in most of the discussion. So I tried to look at slavery as a worldwide phenomenon, and it's something that's lasted for thousands of years. I also tried to ask the question, why did it end? It ended here because of a civil war, but it didn't end anywhere else because of that. It took over 100 years to root it out.
And it's been here before that.
And again, the literature, there's tons you can find, the shelves groaning with books about the United States, the Western Hemisphere, and Africans, but virtually nothing about the rest of it. This book about the Europeans enslaved by North African pirates came out in 2003. By 2004, you couldn't find a copy. It had, for all practical purposes, gone out of print. There was just no interest in it. Racism in the United States grew out of slavery, but slavery didn't grow out of racism. The Europeans enslaved other Europeans for centuries before the first African was ever brought to the Western Hemisphere.
I mean, it's just like when someone just takes advantage of the vulnerable. That's that kind of situation.
That wherever there were people that were vulnerable for whatever reason, those were the people that were preyed upon. Even though for most of history, those who enslaved and those who were slaves were the same race.
In your opinion, what has to be done in the black schools or among black students in order to bring them up?
One, you get rid of the things that are dragging them down. You stop saying that speaking black English, you know, is just as valid and all that kind of stuff. It may be just as valid to linguists and so forth, but the fact is, if you talk that way, you're not likely to get into med school, you're not likely to do very much in your life.
Hey, if you want to get that money, you got to talk that lingo, baby. To be as if is to act as if.
If you were still living 50 years from now, what would you predict the black race in this country would be?
Oh, wow.
I mean, based on trends that you've seen in the last 20, 50
years. It could go either way. If the current trends continue, it's going to be a disaster. But there's evidence that the current trends are not unchallenged. People from time to time ask me to mention some black conservative writers. And I tell them, 30 years ago, I could have told you Walter Williams and me. And today, I can't even keep track of them all. They're all over the place. They're in the media. They have their own shows. They write columns. They write books. And I learn about them, from nowhere. They suddenly appear. So there is this counter trend going on. And everything depends upon which wins out in the end.
Deep, 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 deep. Hey, with that being said, if you like what you saw, make sure you hit that like, definitely leave a comment, smash that subscribe button, and definitely hit that notification bell. We'll be back with some more Thomas Sowell. On that note, see you in the next one. Love, yo. And don't forget, I'm at 9,500. I need 5 more hundred just to reach 10K. Let's go, baby. Hit that, hit that, hit that.